I'd like to call the special meeting of September the 5th of the Salisbury City Council to order. First thing I would like to do is ask you all to please silence any electronic devices you have that may make noise. I will do the same. If during the meeting an emergency should arise, let me think where I am, you exit the room, make a left-hand turn, and go down the stairs. If that exit for some reason is blocked, you make a right-hand turn, go to the end of the hall, make another right-hand turn, and go down the stairs. If you need assistance, please let us know, and we'll be happy to provide it to you. At this time, I'll entertain a motion to adopt the legislative agenda as presented.
So moved.
Second.
Mr. Ireton, Ms. Jackson. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
And the chair votes aye. I'll entertain a motion to approve ordinance number 2435.
So moved.
Second.
Mr. Boda, Ms. Jackson.
Need to make an amendment to ordinance number 2453. Making an amendment. I'm going to do it all in one amendment. Line 17, we need to change $41,128 to $20,000. Line 20, we need to change $20,000 to $41,128. Line 28, we need to change $20,000 to $41,128. And line 29, we need to change $41,128 to $20,000.
How do you know all that?
Did you say line 17 changed to?
They told me.
Okay.
what happened was.
Good answer.
Good for me.
I think it was 19 you said.
20,000. It was line 17.
That stays 1741.
Hold on. Let's make sure we get it right. What happened was inadvertently the two amounts were switched to the wrong department. It was in the wrong department.
Oh, hold on a second. So,
but the whereas clauses are correct.
The whereas clause is just the
okay.
The
just
two,
the
number.
The so ones then on it's the just line 28 and 29.
Right.
Okay.
Thank you.
So strike line 17 and 20, line 28, 29.
Okay, what's line 28?
Line 28 is supposed
just
to
just switch
be,
the number.
Just switch it, oh, okay.
Yeah, they're rejected. Okay.
So we have a motion to amend. Is there a second to the motion?
I second.
Ms. Jackson seconds. I'll call the amendment first. All those in favor of the amendment to the motion. Ordinance number 2435, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
And the chair votes aye. Mr. Tillman?
Okay. This is ordinance number 2435, an ordinance of the City of Salisbury approving a budget amendment of the fiscal year 2018 general fund to appropriate funds for a National Folk Festival event manager. Whereas the City of Salisbury has been awarded the National Folk Festival event for 3 years, and whereas the City of Salisbury has determined that there is much work related to the event requiring a manager, and whereas the City of Salisbury has determined the manager position will require an additional appropriation of $61,128 to cover the salary-related fringes for the contracted position in fiscal year 2018, whereas the City of Salisbury has determined that certain promotions budgeted for fiscal year 2018 will not be required by the Fire Department, resulting in $41,128 to be available to fund the manager position for FY 2018, whereas the City of Salisbury has determined that a maintenance contract for new dispatch equipment budgeted for FY 18 will not be required by the Police Department, resulting in $20,000 to be available to fund the manager position for FY 2018. Now, therefore, be it ordained by the City Council of the City of Salisbury, Maryland, the City's fiscal year 2018 general fund budget be amended as follows. There'll be an increase in the budget development by $61,128, and there will be a decrease in the Fire Department by $41,128 and a decrease in the police department by $20,000.
Questions? I have one. Taking the $20,000 out, that's not going to stop the project that we had for the...
No, there was some saving cost savings that they found.
That's what I like to hear. That's good. Any other questions or comments? Hearing none, I'll call the motion. All those in favor of ordinance number 2435 for the first reading, please signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
And the chair votes aye. Thank you all. Okay, if there's no other business for the special meeting, I'll accept the motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
All right, all those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
And chair votes aye. We are adjourned. Thank you. Good afternoon. I'd like to welcome everyone to the work session of September the 5th, 2017. The first item on the agenda is the criminal nuisance legislation. We have Chief Duncan and Ms. Phillips. I thought I saw Chief Duncan.
She's coming back. She's with
Colin. Okay.
We did
that
just included
code
enforcement, not
PD. I just wanted to know, because I know I was like, time
work. Well, that was the wrong one. I'll pass this around because the wrong cover memo got got plugged in there. You'll see Tom's name. It didn't even happen. And Chief Duncan will be right back. She's just making a copy of something.
Do we have any more?
Susan.
Okay. Yes.
I got it. Thank you. We can make a...
Can you send me the one?
Okay. No.
Here, Kevin. Thanks.
I'm trying to stay here a little. Get it on the
okay.
Ledge. Good
afternoon, Chief.
Good afternoon, everyone. Sir, how are you?
Good, thank you.
We currently have property maintenance, chronic nuisance, property legislation on the books that just addresses code enforcement violations. It does not include any police department calls for service. And that quantifies 5 calls for service in a 12-month period. Talking with Chief Duncan, we definitely have a need to include the SPD calls for service because, as we all know, bad housing and crime go hand in hand. So we always have the same properties that come up all the time that she and I are both working on and combating. So we're including the same legislation that we currently have on the books, and we're including the SPD calls for service to try to put a stop to these same properties that are distributing services from the city of Salisbury. So we upped the calls from 5 to 7 in a 12-month period. In this new legislation, we've included SPD calls in the lines 28 and below are the ones that you'll see that are excluded. Basically, they're domestic issues, family issues, anything that should not be included. And then on the second page down the bottom, 1527030 under property B, it talks about for a rental property. Now, this legislation goes for homeowner and rental. It does not discriminate between that. But in the case of a rental, that for the first time that the person is a chronic criminal nuisance property owner, the first time their registration will be suspended for 6 months, the second time for 12 months, and the third time for 24 months.
And that's on that specific property, just to be
only the property. It doesn't go for all
not
of their
for
properties,
all the properties.
No. And as usual, they have the right to appeal.
Which board will this go to?
The HBA, Housing Board of Adjustments and Appeals. Now, for the municipal infraction, that will go, which will be issued, that will go to district court. So Chief and I are here for questions regarding the calls themselves and any other questions you guys might have.
Well, before we open it for questions, I'd like to thank Mr. Boda for sending you the list of, and really compiling a fairly good list.
Yes.
And then some, you know, your responses sort of helped because it took a lot of my questions out of the equation. But I'll open it for any questions.
Were those the questions that he just, did he email us?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, 421, those? Is that the set of questions, 421?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's what we got, okay.
Yep. Any questions that weren't answered in the memo?
Having just seen this at 421, I haven't...
Yeah, I'm sorry, I...
That's okay, no, I didn't tell you
last night, I sent it, and then she responded today, so I forwarded it.
Take some time to read it, Jim.
No, I'm looking at this at line 79. It says, for any previously designated chronic nuisance property that has not received a chronic nuisance property designation. Okay. And... Okay. So you've got to go 5 years clean before the slate gets clean. Yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Can I ask this question? Mm-hmm. Has anybody from the Salisbury area property ever seen this so that we don't go to legislative session?
They've seen it in 2014.
Okay.
All of this legislation is adopted.
Okay.
It was adopted in 2014. But now the criminal piece.
Okay.
That's the new piece.
Because I don't want to say it's going to go to legislative session and then be bombarded for weeks like we were previously on some things. I'd like to know that their representative group, or like to hear what they had to say about it anyway before it's been the paper.
Representative.
Oh. Have you seen this?
Just like Mayor Day said. Mm-hmm. So what I'd like to present is us to offer up our services and maybe redline it, stay within the way you're structuring it, not to lessen it or make it more draconian. Stick with what you're trying to go for, but inject in there our requirements as landlords, and that is to go through the court to get rid of the occupant who is the problem. That chews up time. And there's nothing we can do about that. We just can't go in there and throw bodies through windows and do self-help. If we have a problem, we want to address it, which means we have to go through court, which means the calendar starts to tick. As you guys know, with some of your issues you've had off Camden Avenue. So that's what we'd like to prove there, is if we show we're performing as landlords to address the occupant who's the problem, we can demonstrate court paperwork that says we're trying, don't keep hitting us with, you know, 5, 6, 7, all of a sudden now we turn into a pumpkin, that house loses its rental registration, and now we're not only going to get the guy out of there in the next 30 days or 45 days, now we can't even re-rent for 6 months. So the landlord gets punished. The occupant is going to be a bad occupant, no matter if he's with us or he buys a house or moves into Baltimore.
I have a couple of things to say about that. When we were talking about this legislation, we talked about at around the fifth violation, we would send out a warning to the property owner so they're not blindsided when they get the section of the seventh, or they get the seventh saying that you are now designated. So they have some warning.
The first one too, right?
You get all of them, but if you're nearing that designation, you're made aware of that. So the landlords can incorporate this into their lease, saying if you become, you know, if you're in danger of, if you have so many calls for service from the PD or from Housing Community Development, you are subject to eviction.
Right.
So it's built right into your lease. You have the team to
it.
It does. And if you call the department and say,
okay,
I got you, I'm at 4, I'm doing the eviction process, can you hang on, absolutely.
Yes, we have legal relationship. I believe you. We won't have a problem, but if we can put that in the wording a little bit, so it's just not lost in the name, the occupants in the room.
I can, we can put in there that a warning letter will be sent out at the fifth. We are going to have.
I think maybe what he's asking for is in the legislation is if the landlord is working with you and is a part of the process of like, hey, you know, we've submitted to get this person evicted. I think what he's asking is that can we suspend any additional points if the person gets arrested again?
And I think Councilman Vogt is correct, except it has to be that the person is getting evicted. It cannot be, well, I'm working with them.
No.
Right. I'm working with them.
Well, I mean,
once it's in the work eviction process.
It's got to be evicted.
It's got to be in the process because he could try to evict somebody and go to court and the judge say no. I mean, which is, again, not his fault.
And I think Mark can word that correctly in there just by saying if the property owner provides poor documentation proving an eviction, the city shall cease enforcement until the time of the eviction.
Yeah.
And then that basically gets them on hold.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm fine with that because ultimately we just want to curb behavior at the property.
I think my other question was, and I think Susan was leaving this for the chief, was, you know, there's a call for service, but if the person is, you know, sometimes a case can hang in court, sometimes years. And if you're trying to do something on a yearly basis as far as having a call for service count as a point, what if they hit that 7 and then the person's case down the road is overturned and they're fined $500, do they get that back? Because then it's ultimately it was a call for service, but it wasn't a conviction because they weren't on appeal. I mean, is there some avenue in there for something like that?
Well, the legislation reads call for service, not conviction.
Well, but it, I mean, in it, it was talking about, so if, and I guess the concern that I have with that, if you're dinging somebody for the police coming out and arresting somebody for somebody reporting a crime on the property and the person's found not guilty, or it's NOPROS, or it's step docket, or it overturned on appeal, you're still dinging the landlord for something that happened. And because not every person that gets arrested is convicted.
Right. And I understand that. So Chief can probably help.
Do we get the lawyers
involved? Yeah, help explain that. So,
yeah.
Mark.
You know, the other side of it, you get somebody with six gigs.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You got a bad actor. Yeah. Let's understand. It's not, you know, one off may be fine, but you got somebody who's got six calls, and they've been there. Chief's been there 4 times or 5 times, just for that side of it.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the guy, they want to get rid of that guy anyway.
But is it on the house address or is it on the occupant for those months or years?
It's on the house address.
Yeah, so we could get rid of the guy, the house address contains the 4 or 5 hits. Somehow we get another bad apple in there, mm-hmm. They get 2 hits, next thing you know.
Well, about time.
Yeah. Well, and I think...
I don't mean to say it like that, but with the chronic properties, and I could go down Shiloh Street and show you many examples where, oh, thank God they're gone, and 2 weeks later another sets in, mm-hmm. And it's an all-night thing. And
right on.
That's mm-hmm. That's something that the industry has to take up itself.
One of the things that we've asked before, and we talked about it, is that we're going to have to depend a lot on you guys to enforce your side of it. And I didn't know that, like, you said something funny.
Yeah, you did. You must not live by a bunch of rentals.
Okay. We'll give you time to, if you want to speak at the end of the...
Since I am a property owner and resident, since I wasn't even addressed in this conversation, there is the landlord for...
Well, we didn't get to... I have your sheet right here, and you'll have plenty of time to do it. And if you don't... calm down and behave yourself, I'm going to ask you to leave. Okay?
Okay.
Thank you. Okay. So anyway, we talked about that, and we expect that to be held up. And I understand that there's extenuating circumstances. But Jim's exactly right. We have houses that are chronic houses. Chief, you know, it's like when you hear the address come over the thing. Oh, here we go again. And that we can't. We got to stop it. We have to find a way of stopping it. So I fully understand what you talk about when you start the eviction process. It's in the hands of the courts. I support what Mir said. What Susan's recommendation is, I think that's a good one. But we have to really fix the problem. So anyway, Chief?
Could I say something?
Sure.
But if you're evicting these people, the same people, and they go back to another community, and there's a problem created all over again.
Well,
I
do know this, that a lot of the landlords have a list of bad actors that have come from other places, and they should be very careful.
I think remember that this legislation doesn't initiate any eviction process. That's between landlord
right.
and
tenant.
Yeah, I understand that.
Right.
So this doesn't change or accelerate an eviction process. I mean, that's really up to the property owner, the landlord. And remember, this also affects homeowners too.
Yeah.
Their calls for service. So I think, you know, you let the eviction process stand on its own. Mm-hmm. The only way those two intertwine or integrate here is if you could stop the process, as we've discussed, if the eviction process is ongoing. I don't think it's appropriate for us to continue applying a point or, you know, a point for a call for service if there's a question of whether or not that's being addressed through the courts, through the eviction process. Otherwise, I say, you know, we do our thing, and the courts handle their thing, and the landlord handles their thing.
Chief, you had a comment?
Absolutely, and just to address Councilman Sabin's question regarding the step docket or the conviction, my colleague is absolutely correct. We looked at this from the deployment and use of resources on a continual basis at a specific location. So not every interaction that we have results in an arrest or a conviction. But the fact that we're actually taking very, very valuable resources time and again and applying those resources to a problem that is something that's really problematic for the whole neighborhood, that really was our focus. We don't make an arrest on every call that we go to, but that doesn't negate the level or the amount or the volume of resources that we deploy to resolve a problem in a particular area or at a particular location. So that's why the focus was call for service versus conviction.
Thank you.
Was there anything to the change? And I don't know who did this or when it got on there, the 5 to the 7. Did we do that back in the day, or is that new to this?
This is new.
Was there any suggestion as to why that was? Any discussion as to why it was moved from 5 to 7?
Because we were adding additional, just the addition of the SPD calls.
Percentage.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
April, you have a question?
Oh, no.
You okay?
I'm fine.
Okay.
I'm fine.
Any other questions?
No, I'm good.
No, you go.
I was going to say, I think my big thing was if there's an eviction process, that we have a mechanism in there to put a pause on it, and I think is fair, mm-hmm. and that was really my biggest concern.
So, I agree.
So I'm working with Mark to add that.
Yeah, I agree with that.
I think that's good to have it.
Is that what you wanted?
When that's done, could you resubmit it to us so we can get it ahead of time to look at it?
And rather than handling the warning letter by policy, can we just work that in the legislation too?
Yeah. Okay, Mr. Smith, you requested a minute,
Censored or uncensored?
I think you should respect. I think you should respect the people who are in the room.
I certainly do, and I also respect all the citizens. Salisbury, not a few anointed Kings. So, I don't understand why, what brought my ire up was that, and it wasn't Jim's fault, it just happened to be in the conversation, that he turns around and refers to the Landlord Association as if they have a major part in this issue, which they do, but I don't see any organized representatives from the city who are individual property owners here. When do they get to have a say-so and know when and where we can have this say-so? Unless you follow council or you follow the news. But a lot of people are actually, they have jobs, they work, which makes them, I hate the word, but apathetic. I doubt they'd be apathetic if they really knew what was going on. Well, they probably got a glimpse when the council raised our taxes again. And again, I'm not seeing any improvement whatsoever in the behavior of the area I live in. They've got numerous liquor bottles, trash, homeless people accosting me in front of the Wycomico County Liquor Store, which also houses Acme, Walgreens, Rite Aid. They're everywhere. And they're dangerous because as I was coming here, I went to Walgreens to pick up a prescription. And on the wall of Walgreens was the same man with a little child and a woman, young woman, with his little sign, cardboard sign, saying family needs help. Well, we just got, $800,000 from the state through Wycomico County. And let me rephrase that. Wycomico County is going to give it to homeless centers to what? Increase the population of the homeless, and where are they all coming from? And to deny and reject the fact that these people, if they want to be taken care of, they will be taken care of. There is no reason to be sitting on the corner of the Walgreens being aggressive, because I took his picture. This was Saturday. I'm talking about today. Same guy, same place. He saw me coming and he recognized me. And he got up and he was going to do something. The only reason he's sitting there or should be sitting there is no reason. Because if he's begging for more money, he's got food, he's got shelter, he's got everything else. It can only be for drugs or alcohol. And if you go in front of Wycomico Liquor Store, just look at the parking lot. What they call them, miniatures, they're everywhere. They go in and I've seen them do it. I didn't have my camera at the time. They walk down to the end of Acme, pop that miniature, gulp it down in one sip, throw the bottle on the parking lot, and off they back go with their bike.
How does this relate to the legislation we're talking about now?
Because now, in addition to that, I'm talking about in general, the trash everywhere. I went down South Boulevard picking up trash when the college people came back. It was everywhere after the weekend they moved in. And it's been bad because we've got, I don't know where they're coming from, but I believe it's, Oakville townhouses, but just a massive amount of people up and down, moving in, walking, and all of a sudden there's trash on every sidewalk, on every property, and it's, most of it is, well, it's all kinds of trash, but there are an awful lot of liquor bottles in front of a rental house on South Boulevard. I picked up 11 miniature bottles of vodka right in the front yard. So I guess what I'm saying is, number one, let me ask, wasn't there legislation before this and ordinances passed for repetitive complaints already?
Yeah.
This is new?
No, this isn't new.
Okay, so if they have a repetitive complaint, there are already ordinances on the books, right? And I personally have sent you photographic evidence of multiple times on one property, and guess what? You're about to get another roundup for the same properties. Is it a monetary fine now? What is this doing to change other than eviction?
Eviction is not part of our legislation.
Okay, then what is different about this than what you currently have?
This is including SPD calls for service.
What?
Including Salisbury Police Department calls for service.
Okay, so what are you doing? You're adding, I'm confused. Because my understanding.
I just drew this picture for myself. It's now 7 calls for service, either from code violation or police calls. We're adding in, it was just like that before. It was just
seven code calls. Okay.
And now it's adding police calls as well.
Okay, my mind may be foggy because this has been going on for so long and through so many mayors, so many councils. Wasn't there an ordinance passed on numerous violations, and then the fines would go up accordingly? Is that gone, or was that ever in there?
I take it that this, what's being recommended today, piggybacks on what that was and amends it, and including Salisbury Police Department complaints, whereas before it was just the housing code and HCDD concerns. So now if you have a property where the police are also being called, that's also contemplated and reaching a point where there'll be fines. And for rental properties, the revocation of their ability to rent that property, which ultimately will result in eviction if that were the case.
Is that
the case? And is there any contemplation from whom, you know, how the source of the call and the credibility of the source of the call? Because I could be a person that lives across the street and just doesn't like the property across from me.
It has to be a call behind violation. So just because someone calls and says there's a violation and we go there and find it's unfounded does not mean that it's going to qualify.
But I think what Hardy's asking is, what about call for service?
Yeah.
And what if somebody just calls and says?
It would not be included.
How do we make that determination?
By performing an inspection on the property and finding violations.
Yeah, I'm talking about
for the Salisbury
Police Department.
Well, we would give a disposition on the call. Okay, if the call is unfounded, that's how we would
Right. One of the concerns
because
that
anybody
we have,
can do a frank call.
Good. Yeah. So, okay.
No, I think you have to wrap up because generally we have a 4-minute limit on speaking on the topic. So. If you'd wrap up, that would be fine, and then we'll continue.
Well, I don't mean to go on, but I do mean for you to understand some of the facts. And first of all, you're saying 7 calls. That's a lot of calls before any action's taken. Not police calls. By the time you probably get to the 3rd call, you probably have enough of it. But I don't know what you can do. I mean, arrest them by then. But 7 calls for you, it seems like an awful lot because it's leaving the property in disarray longer and longer and longer. And I have a property next to me that's been empty for years. Actually, there are 2 of them that no one ever fixes up. No one does anything. They just get worse and worse. What do you do about that?
All right, Mr. Smith, I'm going to have to cut you off. I'm sorry to do that. But
did she answer my question?
I didn't even know there was a question in there, but let her try.
If there's exterior violations, I'd have to look at the property itself to address, to see what violations there are to tell you what would happen with those.
Okay.
I can't tell you that there's not violations. I don't have an address or the database to look it up.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, Jim, you had a question.
Just a question about the information and how it's different. Before, we used Comcate And those things change every 3 days as to what the newest thing is for everyone to use. Are we still using that?
We are going to be switching to a program where you remember that. You remember when you used to always say that you should be able to go into one program and get everything? It's coming. We can go on to there and get building permits, water, have water, PD, HCV, everything. Like
a decent dashboard.
And it's going to make this very, very easy.
Okay.
So for a cause of service, will people have an opportunity to appeal?
Yes.
Any other questions?
You asked if they can appeal the call for service to see if it's...
Any violation that is written up is appealable. Every individual violation. And then their determination of property maintenance. Property is appealable.
So I guess the big departure here then is that a call for service from the police department, the only appeal forum would be the Housing Board of Adjustments and Appeals, who are not going to be really equipped to make determinations, but will have to base the review in totality the numbers of points against them based on the testimony of. You know how HBAA works. The city is one side, and the attorney for the board, so Pete Gold at that time, will be the attorney who will provide, I guess, guidance to the board. It is a departure from what we've traditionally done, but I can't think of another forum where the call for service can reasonably be appealed.
And I guess really what's being appealed isn't necessarily the call of service.
Not necessarily.
It's
actually
the totality,
totality
of the both situation.
Well, you arguably, if a determination were made that you were a chronic nuisance property, you would have the right to appeal all of those calls. You could say, well, three of these don't qualify.
Mm-hmm.
So that's. Can I just go back to the property you and I were on, Elizabeth Street, 210? That one could rack up, but that person's in jail. That's the first residential property off the highway, right there at where Elizabeth Street comes out, near some of our favorite parts of Salisbury.
That owner-occupied?
No.
It's vacant.
It's vacant. So I'm just trying to figure, just if he's got empty ones and I've got empty ones and we're finding empty ones.
We could take that.
That's what Susan suggested. I just, it's not going fast enough. It's not going fast enough for relief for people who are living near these things. So I'm just wondering if, well, even if you did this, you would eventually go to receivership anyway.
Mm-hmm.
Freedom. Thank you.
One of the most effective tools here is that any landlord, I think, once this is passed, should put in his lease a provision that if you are tagged under this law, that I have the right to evict you. And once they do that, that's really, I think, in the end, going to be the most effective tool. Because landlords really, just because someone's a pain in the neck doesn't give you the right to evict them under the law. But if we put that in the contract, they'll have the right to do that.
Yeah. Good point. Okay.
There's a hand.
Can I see a hand?
Vehicles wouldn't be called for service. And weeds and sidewalks, that's not called for service.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. It's code violation.
Mm-hmm.
It's not police call for service. It would be. That's already covered.
That would count as one. It's a qualifying violation.
That currently contributes to it. But there aren't many people that get
set. That hasn't changed.
Yeah. Susan, remind me, because on my street, the one that you guys kept tagging, they moved to another side of the street in front of a vacant home. So I'll give you the address on that.
The one on Shiloh just turned it around.
That's a flat tire.
I'm fine.
There's a lady.
Oh, back
in the back. I'm sorry.
There.
As a landlord and City of Salisbury. I just have a question. You manage multifamily communities, not single family communities, you know, apartments for rent or homes for rent. How would this affect, this new change affect multifamily dwellings? And then the second part of my question is, for landlords, you don't know who you're going to get till you get. So despite doing initial verifications and seeing if they're eligible credit criminal landlord, if that person does not have a criminal history and doesn't have anything to exempt them from moving onto a property, once you move out the person that was the offender and you move someone in who starts to offend again in that same address, you're going to hold the landlord responsible?
Yes.
Yeah, that's not a new concept at all.
So I'm just trying to figure out if, you know, how does this affect multifamily with multiple addresses in one community? And, you know, how do you hold the, you know, start over? Didn't you start over with the point system with a new resident versus continuous?
It affects multi-unit structures the same way, because in an apartment building, each unit is registered individually. Just to say there's a 10-unit building and unit 3 is the violator, so that one would have its registration suspended, not the whole building. And then the only time that the clock starts over, for lack of a better word, is calendar year. So it wouldn't start over with new tenancy.
Any other questions or comments? Chief, yes.
Yes. Councilman Boda, you're talking about an abandoned vehicle. Is that on the street somewhere?
I think I saw something, like, I think somebody had put a ticket on it or something. It had flat tires, and then it...
Yeah, where?
It was, I'll get with you after. I don't want to call out addresses.
Yeah. All right.
The only question I have is, as far as, I know we said it by property, do we need to somewhere maybe add in, like, unit in multifamily complexes somewhere in there to identify? I know she said it.
I thought unit was in there.
It is.
Is it in there?
It is.
I couldn't
remember if it was in there or not. Mm-hmm.
I think it is.
Yeah, the dwelling unit. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Oh, dwelling unit.
Dwelling unit.
Okay. All right. Mm-hmm. Sorry.
Yeah.
Good. Okay.
Right. So, and each one would require its own registration anyway.
Right. Okay.
Okay. Do we have consensus to move on?
Yes.
With the changes?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Yeah.
Hardy.
Yes or no?
We have consensus to move on?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I thought you were asking if I had any questions.
No.
Yeah.
I'm just trying to make it simple.
Does this mean it'll be on legislative session next time?
With the changes.
Mm-hmm.
It occurs to me that somebody's here writing about it.
Yeah.
They've given the Salisbury that I know and love, that there'll be more questions. I would just be a suggestion, we don't have to do it, but it would be my suggestion that we give it 2 weeks, revisit it again at a work session to find out if there are any more of the questions like yours that you brought up.
Yeah.
If there's something else out there from the homeowner community or the rental community that says, how does this apply to me? I would say this is not for the properties that are most of the time owned by the people in the Property Owners Association. Okay. These are out-of-town people. These are people that you can't reach. These are people that have no address where you can get a hold of them.
And then
I don't know whether or not the car on Shiloh Street turned around so you couldn't see the expired tags from Texas would have led you to all three bikes inside that house, but that's exactly what happened. That's where that car was. And I personally have been on that car for at least 2 years when it was parked out front and then brought around back. So, though I understand you don't always know who you're going to get. If you've got one place and it turns into trouble and your next one turns it into trouble, the trouble is not with them, it's with you. I just think there's, I think there's going to be more questions, but I'll go ahead and vote to move it forward because I'm sure they'll come.
Brett, are you going to report back to Sepulveda?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
And I'd like to, I know we have a neighborhood association meeting on the 10th, which is Sunday night.
No, I thought it was sick.
No, it was moved because of a death. So I'd like to take it there as well, but I can come back with questions if they have a legislative session.
Okay.
Okay,
yeah, that's fine.
Yep. If I may ask one more question, $100 fee for appeal, that could be prohibitive for some people.
That's consistent with the other appeals that we have.
I could just see a situation where if I'm a renter and I'm having an issue, and then I have to come up with $100, that's outside of my budget. It could be problematic.
It's not the renter, it's the owner.
Is it the owner?
Mm-hmm, it's not the owner.
Well, that's
who gets the fine, the owner.
I'm not saying it shouldn't be there. I guess what I'm asking is there any
like
way?
A hardship.
Huh?
Like a hardship waiver?
We only reimburse that if it's overturned. If it's overturned, they get it back. And that is consistent with other or other code sections where there's the right to appeal. It's a $100 fee.
But I understand that. Yeah. But then that could be prohibitive. So what that means is people that are not financially situated to just randomly come up with $100 don't have full access to our processes and procedures. So
but if they have a good case, they'll get their money back.
I guess the question.
What he's saying is, what if they have a good case but they don't have the money?
I guess the question is, if they're operating a business and they somehow can't come up with
$100,
pretty shocking.
Well, I think he was more talking about a homeowner who might be an elderly individual who limited income. That I think is what he's.
We do have hardship waivers.
Hardship waivers.
We have it for.
I'm not saying that it's something that will come up often. I'm just saying I would hate for someone to think, oh, I don't have $100, and then not access the appeals process.
Yeah, to see a homeowner that maybe have it.
Again, we don't have it for appeals fees, but maybe we could. We have it for other things.
Yeah.
Can you? I mean, maybe Mark.
Yeah, that would be something that should. If you're going to do it, it should be apply across the board.
All appeals fees.
Mm-hmm.
Could you research that?
Yeah, I mean, you can do it. Okay. I mean, the state does it now. If you need to file a lawsuit, you can prove that you don't have the clerk. You know, I mean, any lawsuit you file is going to cost you filing fees, and those can be waived by the court if you prove to the court that you don't have the money.
What do you think?
Something to think about. I think it would be a good thing for us to
basically have a financial affidavit type thing that the person has to file with their.
We can handle that separately as a separate item. Yeah.
That would
it doesn't
that would
have to be tied
be
into this specific thing. You just apply it to all the hold fees.
Tim can add that to the council list of items.
We put it on the pending list. Tomorrow at the meeting, we'll put it on the pending.
Mr. Council President, we were going to talk further with Chief Junkin about. Crime issues. Do you want to move to another one instead of we're an hour?
We're going to be here a while, so it's up to you.
We just can
let's
I
have the next.
Can I plead that
let's put,
it
no,
is
we'll put
specifically
it on,
put on?
We'll put it on specifically
agenda.
For
the
next.
The public safety discussion, the quarterly discussion, is being put on as per our conversation at the last work session. Is being put on the legislative agenda, or the work session agenda, but it wasn't this meeting.
We'll definitely put it on the next one, Jim.
Thank you.
Remind me tomorrow to do it. Oh, you're going to be here tomorrow.
I'll be here tomorrow.
Well,
I'm off it.
Oh, okay. Good. We're okay. We'll remember. I'll write it down. All right, we do have consensus, so we'll close out that one. Thank you. You're still here. You're on your second item. That's the definition of immediate family. Steve, thank you.
Thank you. So, this is an amendment to the definition section of the proper maintenance code for rental of residential premises, section 1526.030 definitions, and it's to include the definition of immediate family. And this is to exclude from the licensing requirements in certain situations of the use of a dwelling unit by immediate family members. So this is just to include immediate family, means a parent, spouse, sibling, or child of the property owner that is related by blood or legally recognizes such as shown on submitted appropriate legal documentation. And it's simply that. It's just if someone is renting to someone who meets that definition, they do not need to register the property with us. I think that'll help simplify things and clarify things for the landlord registration process and enforcement for us.
The only thing that when I read it, is there going to be a problem with enforcement?
No, because we do a little bit of digging to make sure that what someone's telling us is actually the truth.
Okay, so that's going to say. Okay.
Whenever a case like that comes up, it is brought to my attention, so I make the okay before we just let it go.
Okay.
Because we do have cases, and we've had cases where we have been told wrong. So it's basically like an investigation when we're told certain things.
Okay. Any other questions? Anybody have any comments? No.
And what this is meant for, say you're renting a house to your elderly mother. It's those situations. It's not that someone could rent to their extended family.
Gotcha.
So that's why we made it very close and just immediate. And this is also right on the same lines. It's consistent with the definition of immediate family by HUD. So we're right, very consistent with the federal
gotcha.
Law.
Any other questions? Consensus before?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Thank you, Susan.
Thank you.
I request a comment on that.
Sure, go right ahead. You have 2 minutes.
It's getting shorter and shorter, isn't it? When you say immediate family and you say you have a way to figure out who's in mm-hmm. there, do you have a list of the names of the people who should be on the lease or in there, or is there a requirement for them to give names and ages like any other government form?
You can ask for leases at any time, and we also have ways of finding out who lives in particular residence.
Okay, because you know I'm referring to, number one, I'm referring to the halfway house, and number two, I believe there are some immigrant families around, but I'm not sure. Seem to have an awful lot of people, but they don't look related to me. So that was my thing.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Susan. Next on the agenda is the revolving loan guidelines. Laura?
How's it going?
Fine, thank you.
So this is something we've been working on for a little bit. I've been with the city for about 4 years, and we have a revolving loan fund that's really only been used once in the 4 years I've been here. I'm not sure how long it was before that. So we were looking at making some changes to the guidelines of the program, and to summarize them, basically, we're just removing the one-third barrier. So the program, as it was before, a borrower could only borrow up to $50,000 or one-third of whatever project they were looking to do, whichever was less.
And so the project could only be $150,000?
They can only get $50,000 for $150,000.
Well, I just can't understand why we... Nobody did pick that up like years ago, and I'll take full responsibility for that. Like, that's just the dumbest sentence I've ever seen.
Not just that, like, this is created in like 86.
No,
this is the 1980s.
Mm-hmm. 1800.
Right. Don't worry. With urban
Chris
development
right,
monies
right.
that came from that Mayor Martin received. And maybe $50,000 in a $150,000 project actually could be a real project back then.
Yeah.
That's, you know, minuscule.
I remember that discussion. Yes, I do.
That's one I don't.
Okay.
So let me ask this question, because this is great. This is awesome. The second one, oh well. Everybody's got a way to think.
Yes. Yeah, and that was
the second concern there on the sheet. I was like, welcome to the world.
And that's just the one thing. I figured I'd let you guys know the what I've seen. And it's one, people wanting fast money. Well, we're not going to have fast money. We need to do our checks and balances. We need to go through the course. So I think there's an understanding with that. But it was really the being strapped by the one-third or $50,000. A lot of the people I've talked to over the past few years have, oh, yeah, we're interested. Oh, not really worth it. And they're going to other lenders.
If that's the case, and the world has obviously changed since when you first heard of this and when I read it and didn't notice it. Is $50,000 too small of an amount to think it would be? When you think about what it's going to take to do Parker Place, $150,000, even if you could get $50,000 of it, would, I don't know, it would, might get a window scraped and repainted and put in the color of the historic district. That would be one window.
But they just redid all the windows.
So my question is, well, I can't imagine how much they paid for it. Did they use revolving loan funds?
No, that was one of the community legacy things.
Right. So should that 50,000 number go up? And just as an aside, how much money is in the revolving loan fund? That's the first question.
There's only about $300,000 in there. So it's not a huge amount of money, but obviously gets replenished.
So community legacy is doing things like the awnings and things of that nature, the cosmetic stuff, which is really the $150,000 range is what we're talking about.
This has been used for like Mojo's, you know,
right,
construction, Market Street renovation.
Chesapeake East used
Chesapeake East, you know, to be able to stand up. If it were slightly larger, I think it'd have the potential, you know, on the conversations that Laura has, like when a business comes and they've got the ability to go to a bank, but, you know, they'd prefer to go to us if we're the, and, you know, the question always gets asked, what can the city do? And, you know, often the answer is,
not when you're talking about $6 million renovation.
$1,000.
This is really for those small and medium sized businesses to be able to help them, and less frequently on a speculative, you know, renovate a building, and more frequently on a, there's a business that wants to go in and you're helping that business, and you, in turn, you're, there's collateral, you know, of the business and their equipment.
Do we put the $300,000 that's in there? Can we put more in there ourselves, or does it have to come from USDA and some of that other?
I think it's pretty much our funds to do with what we want.
I'm trying to give you more.
Please.
The other alternative that the bankers committee has proposed is you can use it to underwrite instead of using it to dole out.
Okay.
And in which case, you know, Bank X, who sits on the bank, what is it now, the Bankers Review Committee? Or
it's the Revolving Loan Advisory Committee now.
You could have them lend, let's say Bank X could lend, but the City of Salisbury's funds could underwrite, and it's like a 1-5, so you could have $1.5 million out on the street from them and underwrite only, you know, 1/5 of that, $300,000. That's one mechanism.
And that's not something we're pursuing here.
Yes.
I suppose Mark advised me that that would be a complete rewrite of guidelines. It is something that we've looked at and might give us a little bit more leverage in helping businesses and helping some of those bigger projects, but it's not something that we have included in this set of changes.
This could help out with some of the entrepreneur things, maybe. Mm-hmm. You know, with them coming downtown, with the garages, because a little, you know, you're not talking about $300,000-$400,000 now. You're talking about underwriting some, getting them started.
Yeah.
$300,000 could go a lot further in one of those cases where you can get somebody who's got a great idea. I mean, just thinking, have we talked to them about the revolving loan, Bill Burke, or?
I don't believe we've pitched revolving loan to them. We've definitely chatted with them about some other funding options. I know Theo's identified a few and sent them their way, but I don't believe revolving loan was a discussion just because of how strapped the program currently is.
Yeah. Well, if you look at what our goals and objectives are with bringing them downtown and trying to retain some of the intellectual abilities and capabilities of our students who are graduating, that might be a good way of doing it, and it's not huge bucks. Where, like Jim said, if somebody's doing a $3.5 to $5 million project, this is not going to do anything.
Yeah. Well, the guarantee program is definitely something we can pursue doing in the future. It's something that HUD is okayed with these funds, and the Revolving Loan Advisory Committee is interested in seeing. But for expediency's sake, the mayor wanted me to approach you with these changes.
Yeah.
For the immediate future, and then we can address it and rewrite some guidelines in the future to do the guarantee program.
I'd like you to also, if you could put on the discussion of raising the $50,000 bar.
On the pending?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. We'll add that to the.
If we put the money in ourselves, we don't have to go back to HUD and ask for those changes to be clear, could we?
They've been pretty clear that we can do what we want.
Yeah.
Okay.
I think we've met the original intent of the 1980s.
Do we have consensus then to take it to first step? Okay. Thank you, Laura.
Thank you.
Next up, who's handling this? Andy?
Would you please?
It's my first one, so it was exciting.
You wait till line 23 question. I love that.
Oh, man. I wish I can say all these words.
Don't worry, Andy, I'll protect you.
I got it.
Yeah.
I come up with a question.
You knew this was not going to be easy.
All right, go ahead, Andy.
Of course.
No, not at all.
Don't blush.
We want a resolution over first. Resolution of the City of Salisbury, Maryland, to combine the Marina Committee into and establish the Port of Salisbury Committee.
We didn't prep beforehand, so.
In one breath. Unless you can do it in one breath in 50 seconds.
Seconds, yes.
Yes, take a deep one. Go first right now.
Let's give us the abridged version.
Yeah, that's great. So we had the Marina Committee, and we are looking to expand it. Since the Marina Committee is changing its scope and we're adding the Marina Landing, we're looking at creating the Port of Salisbury Committee to include some more surrounding businesses, including residential and potentially mixed use with the development of Marina Landing and 500 Riverside and extend down. You should have included in there a map of the boundary.
Yeah.
So you can kind of see, I can also tell you what some of those properties are. But basically on the left, it goes up to, on the south side, up to, just past Oak Hill Townhouses.
Mm-hmm.
And on the north side, that last property is the wastewater treatment plant.
Yep.
And then down, of course, to Mill Street. And then you have some of the membership, what that would look like, similar to most of our other committees, which is a combination of members from the different municipality, or not municipality, different organizations that would be down there, both residential and in business, or special interest.
So what, for instance, the condo association?
Potentially somebody who was living in one of those.
Gotcha.
Properties.
Okay. Chesapeake? Yeah, Chesapeake.
And one of the things that I just add on the map, I think we can also consider expanding that on the north side to the west, for even further down, continuing to the end of all properties adjacent to the wastewater treatment plant. And we could also consider adding the north prong as part of the redevelopment district. I mean, we've obviously got a plan for that area, but we don't have anyone we don't have any commission who advises on, steps in that process. Could be useful. Our original thinking in not including that was just the desire to move away from industrial. But this commission would deal with both industrial development and, mixed use development, as Andy said, and all commercial development, as well as water use, and advising with and working with Del Mar Water Transport Committee, which is a non-city function, obviously. But it's one of the agencies that we work with frequently. And really, it's the only forum where there's conversation about what's happening in our port, is DWTC. And I think while we want to continue to work closely with them, we also kind of want our own internal group doing some planning.
Yeah, that was the only question I had, not 23. I was just going to chide you about high moral quality. But on 47, I don't know. I know that we started taking some of these out of some of our boards and commissions, people who had a particular financial, it's a fine line. You want to have people who are part of that down there, but don't have a conflict, but at the same time you want to expand it from just boat owners, which is where we were, 5, 6, 10, 25 years ago. So I don't know whether or not that if line 47 causes a
the definition of person, that part.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, it's more who's in that group.
Yeah, it's more more who's in the group.
I think maybe if we hit,
put somebody who lives in one of the high rises and doesn't want more boat traffic and noise, or you put somebody who owns a business there who sees it as a way to
generate funds,
generate revenue. I know it's very hard
for the discussion there.
That there'd be differences of opinion.
I mean, they're going to come to you, and you're going to vet them before they come to us anyway. Mm-hmm. So I mean,
and I think it's fine striking a balance of you want residential and you want waterfront property that people enjoy, but also we embrace Chesapeake Shipbuilding down there.
It's almost that we have this, we have this complicated, diverse, compact waterfront that is still in transition, and you're going to see commercial development on 500 Riverside, residential and commercial development mixed use on Marina, Lot 30, residential and possibly commercial, park and residential and commercial on the north prong. More industrial west of, west of Cato, and I mean, you're gonna have people on paddle boards and barges. There's gonna be, and kayakers and sculls when SU gets their crew team, and it's gonna continue to be a complicated waterway. So having a place where those conversations can happen, and a group that's dedicated to having those discussions.
People didn't know that the barge coming through and putting up the bridge had all their heating oil on it. People would probably go insane about the barge. But every time I have to stop, I'm like, well, we'll get gas next week or gas. No. This goes all the way out to the wastewater treatment plant. Does this take in the area near the piers where we have had previous discussions about Purdue? Does this take in the piers? I can't tell from the picture.
It does.
I guess it could have used
the westerns, the western side of the northern shore.
Because that also changes what you can do with the north prong. It also changes what can be done with a fixed bridge at Mill Street.
And I think if we're going to have conversations with Senator Cardin and Senator Van Hollen, which they want us to have those conversations.
He made a comment when he was down about
I think we've got to have a plan and a place to have those discussions.
Purdue could use the revolving loan fund.
Just slightly outside of the debt.
I know.
I personally think we should add the North Prom.
This
I mean,
part of
it makes sense. It's just
also being developed, just, you know, not future industrial, but also being developed.
Right.
Not to crowd a committee. If we add North Prong, do we need more than seven members?
You know, I'll tell you, my experience with more than seven people.
Is more Stone Shadow?
No, it's just, it becomes unruly.
Kind of like
no, just count. That's okay. No.
So the revision would be a downgrade drawing.
The only thing I had a question, Mr. Mayor, about. I'm a little confused about going west.
Mm-hmm. So let's talk about west.
Yeah,
I would say up to, but not including Harbor Point. It's almost there now. That yellow.
What is that? What's the
property? His
is that?
Yeah,
is that
right
the back of the cottages?
Are you
outside
yeah.
of the yellow line?
I think so.
Is that the cottages?
Right.
Okay. See. Here?
No.
That's that
side
where
it
comes in.
I'm confused.
Hold on.
Wait a minute.
Yeah, but there's the school.
Yeah.
There's the school, so that's got to be the cottages.
It's cottages at River House, yes. That's what
yeah,
you're
looking okay.
For. So that the yellow line follows Marine Road
right.
up to Exxon Road.
Gotcha.
And then, and that's where. That is now an active oil terminal. They've reactivated it. So there is a company there operating now, and Cato is operating two heating fuel and oil terminals active on the river there. So it goes up to the wastewater treatment plant
gotcha.
Property. It doesn't
yep.
include it. It could, basically up to Williams Point, Belle Island Trail. It could stop there, which would just be a little bit further west.
Yeah. Okay.
And this drawing kid is actually technically out on that little
right
point.
I would include them.
Include Cato? They're technically just
that's just their offices.
No, yeah.
Yeah.
So just go and include that whole property. So go all the way to the main.
Okay. Yeah, because they're right behind it.
And then you're saying include North Prong up to
I would go
up to Isabella or include the far side of Isabella?
I would take it to the end because I mean it's all continuous. I mean that's my personal thing. It was everybody else.
The only things on the
north of there.
Yeah, the only things on the far side of Isabella are that city property that was the fire training center.
Right.
That's closed.
On
Isabella,
yeah. Waterfront, but because of the road, but it's
well,
it's
adjacent.
It's waterfront on the north side of that.
Yeah.
So the
yeah.
pond
yeah.
is Johnson Pond.
Okay.
Yeah.
Across the
street.
Johnson Lake.
I'm sorry. I'm just asking the question, if we include North Prong, that should we include the property on the far side
well,
of
the
Well,
if you got lower, you'll be at the Delmar Wastewater Treatment Plant. You got to stop somewhere. You know what I mean? Really. You'll be at Green Hill Yacht and Country Club. You'll be in, yeah. That's
Green Hill.
You know what I mean? You just keep going and
stop
going and going. Yeah. I would stop there. You've
Isabella.
Got to
stop right at the
yeah. lake.
And
it is,
yep.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Isabella.
Yep.
So
yep.
Within that.
Yeah, at that point, it is really all residential on
mm-hmm.
both
yep.
sides once you get up that way.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. The only things, yeah, north of that are that the Salisbury Brick Company and that city fire training
yeah.
center, the closed fire training center.
Any other questions?
You just add to that map.
Nope.
All right, we have consensus.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Thank you, Andy.
Yes.
You made it.
Thank you.
next, we are at the discussion on Rivers Edge Apartments. And I know we have. Where's Susan go?
Right here.
Oh.
So
Susan, before we start, thank you for getting out the information.
You're welcome.
Appreciate it.
You're welcome.
It's always easier when we get the information early enough. Mm-hmm. Give us time to form our opinions and questions.
So as a follow-up to that report, that those letters went out today, those corrective action letters.
Yeah.
When I talked to Courtney today, she had not received them yet. Courtney's here.
Yeah.
And I talked to her also about the issues that we've been having, and basically just let her know that we want to handle the issues on this level here without having to, you know, go up any further. So we're hoping that we can get those resolved at this point.
And actually, my up is here. I have my regional and the vice president of our company, so we're all here to, you know.
Can you sort of like introduce yourselves and stand so I know we know who you are?
I'm the community manager.
I'm Jeannie Hendricks, the senior vice president.
Grace Fidget, regional property manager.
Michelle
Thurston, financial specialist. What questions do you guys have for me regarding the inspections? The compliance date for those are 30 days. So we'll have 30 days to make the repairs. And the tenants were very welcoming. They were really wanted us to do the inspections and wanted us to come in. And seemed relieved that we were there to do them.
Have they seen the list yet? They haven't received it?
They have not gotten it.
Can we get them sort of copies of the, so they can see the extent of what we're talking about?
Yes.
What was the other property that was also, that was on one of the emails? What was the other property that's managed by the same?
Village at Mitchell Pond.
Oh, Village at Mitchell Pond.
But that didn't have a long list of,
no,
of problems.
No.
What was the other? There's another one.
There's another Runaway Bay.
Runaway Bay is the one from the email.
So while we're waiting for the copies, one of the things I'd like to sort of say is, you know, we heard about this at the last meeting, and obviously, apparently, it's been going on for. It's been festering and building up. The sooner we find out about this, the quicker we can jump on top of it. And I would encourage that if the community, you know, everything's communication. And I think that we need to get the information sooner.
Thank you.
It would certainly help us.
Okay.
Now, some of the things on this list, you know, are not code violations, just like addressing, as you know, the maintenance staff and that stuff.
Okay. Well, it would be my suggestion that you have the list, they have the list, that we check back in. And we suggest to residents that they form some sort of association so that they can speak with one voice. Because really, for it to get all the way up here is pretty unprecedented.
Yeah.
Especially in a place that has tax credits attached to it. I can live sometimes with the landlords and the tenants in places who haven't used my tax dollars to pay for it to be open, but this is not a good one in the grocery store.
Yeah. Well, I invited the group from River's Edge to come because I forwarded, as soon as I got it, their response.
Right.
Does anyone on the council have any further questions that they'd like to ask relative to their responses? And then if they would like to make a couple of comments, we'd be happy to listen to the, you know, the response that you have.
Really quick, we will get like what apartment these go to.
And yes, that
okay.
Is. We have a formal report that we issued.
The
formal corrective action letter.
Action letter.
That's what we issued today.
And really quick, because we do have to keep everything computerized. If we find that if some of these haven't been informed, told to us from the resident, can we let you know that? Even though we plan to fix it.
Right. That's regardless.
Just regardless.
Of whether or not they have told you or not, it's still a violation, so it still needs to be corrected.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's corrected, but can we let you know that, it was not addressed from the resident, the management wasn't informed of the issue?
You can if you'd like to, but it makes no difference as far as the violation is concerned, because it still needs to be corrected.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, I just have a question. So, you inspected on the 31st only 18 apartments total, and of the 18, you found 4 that did not have any issues?
Yes.
Okay, and out of a total of how many? 90?
And those are just the ones that we knocked on and asked if they wanted us to do an inspection.
And so when you went to the apartments, did you knock on 100% of the...
No.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you did not knock on 100%?
No.
I do also have another question, because it says right here, not all the HVAC doors were locked where they keep it. So, were they able to tell that there were no air filters? Because we have a preventive maintenance that we do put them in there, actually.
Only the ones that were able to access.
Mm-hmm. So, the people who had access to their units, they probably did not have HVAC filters in them?
I have no idea how that happened, because we replaced them with a water quality.
The ones that the inspector noted did not have any.
Okay.
How interesting is that?
You don't have to answer that question. We were just wondering.
I think that one of the things that maybe I would suggest, because I think Mr. Ireton had a very good point. You've responded to us, and we appreciate the response. But I think I'll go back to my original point, that the communications is what's the key. And the reason we're sitting here right now is because apparently for over a month, April's that when you started talking to them?
No, actually, I started talking to them sometime last year. And it was basically complaints about Courtney and her personality and some other HVAC issues. So by me knowing Courtney from before, Courtney was one of my management, I couldn't believe some of the things that I was hearing. So I just kind of like started investigating and researching some things, and Delegate Sharice Sample Hughes and I had been getting calls from different residents. So we just started just communicating with the tenants, and it seemed like the more tenants started just having complaints, so that's when we came to ask them. We went to them and had a meeting, and then we asked them to come to the city council meeting to explain some of the things that were going on.
And that goes back to my point about,
yeah,
we're not the mediation center.
No,
just so you know, we are not no. mediators.
No,
we are responding to the citizenry. That's what we're doing.
If I could add,
go right ahead
to what you're saying. We employ these 7 code enforcement officers. They have approximately 1/7 of the city each that they have to review on a daily basis. That's, whatever it is, 12,000 housing units plus all the buildings, the commercial building stock. They are busy people. For them to have to go unit to unit because of public complaints is a burden that we cannot allow to happen again and again. So I'm begging you to do the work so that we don't have to. And I don't need a response of any kind right now. I'm just weighing in to explain to you that code enforcement is a very serious job. We've got 7 very overworked, very busy people. And I guarantee you there are properties that require even more attention and developments that require even more attention. So the more a management company can do the work for us and keep us out of their hair, the better off we're all going to be. That way it won't have to result in phone calls to one's city council person or
delegate or senator or whoever. So that's all I'd add. Mr. President, I can't stay.
Are you taking care of on the list and make sure all the other apartments are taken care of?
Yeah, we spoke about it earlier that even the day that they came out, that you guys came out, I called and welcomed them into the community, said if they needed any keys or need to go into any vacant units, you got the, you know, message. And like I said, stated before, we want to make sure that we take care of this for everyone.
Well, we appreciate
that. No. Is a management agent fee managed Owner was contracted by the Salisbury 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 Salisbury